So I got into boxing because my cousin used to box before me. He'd boxed for years before I did. I think I must have been about 5 years old when his dad, my uncle, said to me, "Oh, you're interested in boxing, aren't you?" Because I used to see him bringing his trophies home and stuff. And he used to be like, "Oh, I want one of them." And his dad recognised that. He said to me when he's the right age, when I was 8 years old, he goes, "I'll take you to the gym." When I turned eight, I think it was the same day as well, he took me to the gym. I loved it. But at first it wasn't even the boxing, it was more the atmosphere, being around the lads, having a good laugh. And that's what first drew me to it. But as the years went on, the coach realised, and I realised there was something about boxing that interested me and kept me going. And generally, for at least 5 years, I thought 4 or 5 years, I don't think I missed a session. I used to go to every session. I used to even stay till the senior sessions, just because I wanted to be in the gym and just do what I do. And the coach realised that I've got a talent for it as well. And as the years went on, like I said, at first it was just like a social thing. Then I realised I was quite good at it. But I remember the first day my coach came to me and he goes, "Oh, do you want to start sparring this week?" I looked at him and I laughed. I was thinking, "Is he kidding? I don't want to go in and get punched in the face." But I ended up doing it and, you know, I felt quite good. It was a slow progression, but it was natural for me. Because, like I say, I wasn't in there at first to fight. But at some point down the line, probably after winning my first or maybe second national title, I realised, you know what, I'm quite good at this. I've got something there, so I should stick to it.
The first time you had that spar and you get a punch in the face, you felt what it was like, and then you was willing to say, "Actually, I'll go back and I'll have a few more in the face."
You know, it's weird because, like, anyone will tell you this, even if they start boxing today, they could be 20 years old, that first time they get punched in the face, the eyes always start watering, you know, it feels weird. But then it's weird for us boxers now who, like, get punched in the face all the time and your eyes don't even water. It's just natural now for you, you know what I mean? It's a weird experience, but like I said, I didn't want to get in there at first, but I realised I had something there and I just kept going from there and kept building on it. For me, in terms of getting into the amateur game, it took me a while to find some confidence at first. Like, I remember I won two national titles before I thought to myself, you know what, this isn't a fluke, you know what I mean? I'm actually doing something right. Then I went on to win, I think, altogether about 10 national titles, something like that, including the GBs and stuff like that as well. But in terms of the Olympics, in my head, going up to the Olympics, I always had Amir Khan in my head, because Amir Khan's from the same background as me. He's always been through the same struggles as me as in terms of culture. And he's from up the road in Bolton. I'm from Leeds myself. And I remember when he first qualified for the Olympics. I think this is when I first started believing in me being able to do it. When he first qualified for the Olympics, I remember walking to the gym, right? On the side of the ring, the boxing news was there. And they had all the Olympians and Amir Khan in the middle, because he was the sole boxing representative, wasn't he? And my coach said to me that day, he goes to me, "If he can do it, why can't you?" And since that day, I've always had that in my mind. Obviously, I boxed the Olympics. Didn't go the way I wanted to go, mainly because of injuries. But all that aside, that always pushed me. And it's amazing to, like, it's weird because I'm right now, I'm fighting my second pro fight on Saturday on Amir Khan's undercard. It's mad the way the world works, but I think we're going in the right direction. I'm feeling great now under Kelvin Travis, my new coach. And I think the world's my oyster. I'm learning every day. And just keep a lookout in the pro game for me.
Not at all. Yeah. How did that experience? Nothing. You control the shit. And you don't have to do all that shuffle and boom.
And
you're ready for the shot. You go, you're ready.
He's very receptive to what I've been saying for many years now, but when I was training him when he was a GB member, I couldn't, you know, adjust the armaments that were needed for professionals at that time, because, you know, it's a different stage. And so we spent time on a little bit of fleeting power and a little bit of mobility and staying in the pocket a little bit longer as an amateur. But he's never had that developed at all with GB. They haven't touched the bases they needed to prepare him for anything else other than running around a big 24-foot boxing ring. But the last 6 months have been, you know, some good work. I've certainly been working on stuff, and it's certainly been hard because he's an established performer. Seven years he's been running around the world and doing the stuff at that level. Amateur, even though he's done World Series, did the stuff, you know, provided the goods on the World Series of Boxing stage, then it was still different for him. It was still that bit of a grind that he had to put in there, and he certainly wasn't prepared, in my opinion. But nevertheless, he's moved forwards, that's for sure. We're looking at a little bit of timing elements, a few more balance elements, and I'm looking for a good performance at the weekend anyway. And it'll be the first time I've been in the corner with him, because my son Nigel did it the last time I was away. And there was elements that, you know, that last couple of weeks of training that Nigel did slightly different and I've done slightly different. It's all about the athlete, that's for sure. And it's all about the performance in Liverpool. Great that we go to Liverpool, great stage. Looking forward to it.
Come on. Sit back, give it all. And again.
And you, when the GB came calling, what was that process? Had you just won like a national title again? Had you been doing? And then is that how it works? They sort of scout you and come and have a look at you and yeah, see you to represent.
They basically scout you. I think I must have won about 5 national titles, and I think 3 GB titles before I even got on for trials. I think at the trials in my time there was about at least 60 fighters. 3 got picked. One was me. One was Joe Claudina. And one was Anthony Fowler. And weirdly enough, all 3 of them went to the Olympics. The three that got picked at that time. And but yeah, basically it's a process. You have to go get noticed first, you've got to keep winning titles. Then you get selected to come to trials. And there was 3 trials or 4 trials for us. And after every trial there's less people that come back, and towards right at the end you get a letter sent home saying you've been picked. And luckily for me it was the first time I was trying out and I got picked. But yeah, that was kind of the journey into the GB squad. I ended up boxing with GB for 8 years. Boxed, like I said, everywhere, Europeans, Worlds, Commonwealths, Olympics, all the little tournaments, like Tamar tournaments. I've been all over the world of boxing. And like I said, I think it's setting me really well for the pro game. Like we were saying before, it's weird now because I'm fighting people that, like, with records like Brett Fiddle, who's had about 50-odd fights. He's won about 2-3. It's mad, the records that they have now, but I'm used to fighting people with winning records at like national champions or European champions or world champions or like Olympic medalists. I box all of them and it's a bit of a step down, but right now the main thing is keeping my quality, not going down in my level for them, and showing my ability, and that's what I intend to do on Saturday.
So tell us about Rio then. You get picked for the squad that you're on there with some top fighters, and like you say, we're all now going on and doing what you're doing and doing well in the pros. So, you know, what was it like being part of that GB squad and part of the Olympics in Brazil?
The GB boxing family was always, they'll always be my second family. I grew up with the lads. Obviously, a few of them box a matchroom with me now, like I was saying, Fowler and Cordina. They box a matchroom as well, like I do. And it was like a big family. We'll still call each other, so make sure we're okay. I saw Fowler yesterday at the public workout. Obviously, we don't see each other as much now. But when we do see each other, it's like we've seen each other every day. But yeah, it was always a great atmosphere over there. I bought some of the kids from the GB squad to like cement my place as number one. Qualifying for the Olympics, basically you got to get picked for the qualifiers to even get a chance to qualify. And I got picked for, I think it was the first one, second. I got picked for both, first and second one. It was WSB and the European one. And I qualified with a silver medal in the Europeans. So I had some good kids at my weight, like Peter McGrill. Now he's just won the Commonwealth Games. He's a good kid. He's a talented fighter. He's one to look out for in the bantamweights, in the amateurs now as well. I had some good kids, good competition. But for me, it always made me a little bit harder, and I always made sure I was a step ahead of them all, and it worked out. And by the time I got to the Olympics after qualifiers, I had all sorts of cuts and injuries. So it was a tough one in the Olympics. So it just wasn't meant to be, sort of thing. But for me personally, I feel like if I was 100%, I'd have definitely medal at least. Especially compared to the kid that I boxed, I got beat by in the Olympics. I battered him about a month before a month before the qualifiers. I battered him, literally put him in his place. But then by the time I got to qualifiers, by the time I got to the Olympics, after the qualifiers, I had injuries, so it was a bit harder then. But like I say, what's meant to be is meant to be. I'm happy where I am now. I'm learning all the time, and the main thing now is the pro game and coming up in the pro game, coming up in the ranks, and winning them world titles.
I think I have no problems with him whatsoever. I would not be training anyone who is not receptive at all, because you need that. It needs to be a decent relationship. We've had that relationship, and even though it's been fleeting over the years, you know, coming and going to Moss Side quite a lot, and I've been up to Leeds a few times. The relationship is solid. We're actually establishing one or two routines that really was never there in the amateurs because he's put the work in. You know, and they work, like any coach will tell you, if they work, you're receptive. If they don't work, you know, come on, what's going on? It's a get real game, is the professional boxing. And so I have a lot of, you know, he's a nice guy. He's not the animal that you see in a boxing ring many times. We have to change him into a slightly different animal, a more domineering animal, shall we say. That's not his style. He's certainly a talented performer. He certainly wants it, for sure. But it's not going to come easy, because there's guys out there who want to chew him up. I know that. He knows that. He's had enough in sparring the past 6 months, enough in training. Probably the worst moment we had was in Spain, when he sparred with this super featherweight who was one killer, you know what I mean? He was dynamite. He fell asleep in 6 rounds, he fell asleep for half a minute at the end. I thought I wanted to kill him. I think that was, you know, that's the kind of grounding that he needs. You can't switch off for half a minute, you know, so that's where we're coming from. He's receptive, he knows, he's intelligent. He's an intelligent fighter. He just has to be a bit more ruthless at times, as I'm sure everybody would tell you.
I box loads, like I said, I box everyone around the country. There's no one that I haven't boxed, and there's not a star that I haven't been in with. So in terms of the pro game, I'm set, and I'm ready to face all the styles. And I think what people underestimate about us GB boxers is that the fact that, yeah, I might be 1-0 right now, and people might go in there thinking, oh, he's inexperienced, what's he going to do? But they forget about our past experience in the amateurs and boxing everyone, especially doing WSB as well, doing 5 rounds, and that's semi-pro. And I've boxed the best in the world. I boxed 2 Mexicans in WSB, and in terms of pro game, with the styles that the Mexicans have, what's going to set you up better than that?
Yeah. And that's some competition at WSB.
Yeah, definitely.
Competitive fights. So you're there, you come back from the Olympics, that's it, I'm going to go pro. Was it that kind of thing? Did you decide you might stay on for a bit, or did you always feel that the pro game was for you and you was going to go down that road?
Yeah, definitely, without a doubt. I always said to myself, whatever happened in the Olympics after Rio, I'll definitely turn pro. Like I said, I just turned 25 in March, so it was a perfect time for me. I think I was 24 when I left the Olympics, so it was always that right age for me. I think before that, after London, I might have been a bit young, not young, but a bit less a man. Now I feel like, especially body-wise and strength-wise, I'm there to turn pro, and it's a different sort of game, like you said, over 6, 8, 10, 12 rounds. It's a different sort of game where you need that bit more toughness. And I think after London, it wasn't right for me, but I made sure I got all the experience I could out of the amateur game. Like I say, all the tournaments that I've been to, got to the Olympics and called myself an Olympian. I think it's a perfect time for me, as physically and mentally, to turn pro.
Adapting as we speak, you know, daily, for sure. It is all about the performance. We would like him to go sooner rather than later after this second fight. You do need time to stand back and have a look at yourself when you made that transition to the professionals. You know, you're boxing with the head guard off, and it's the head is allowed to be there a lot more than it was in the amateurs, even though amateurs is moving the same way. I think his first fight against Brett Fido then was a great opening. I think he did certain things wrong there. We've worked on them for sure. His next opponent, Ricky Starkey, is better than his record suggests. Everybody knows that. This guy can fight a little bit. He can, you know, he's awkward enough. He'll pose Kez some problems. He has to follow him out pretty quickly, and that's the job. So that's, you know, that's the task. Nobody's going to give it you. You have to go and earn it in that professional game. We know.
No, yeah, the gym's amazing, especially with all the talent that we've got in there now. But my main coach has always been Kelvin Travis. See, I've known Kel since the amateur days, even before the Olympics. I think it was around the Commonwealth Games times when we first met up, I think 2014. And I've always done a bit of work with Kel over the years, whenever I could. Obviously, when I wasn't on camp or on GB, I'd come see Kel, and Kel's always been like another coach to me, apart from the GB squad. And I think it was just natural when I came back to Leeds to train in Manchester and go with Kel. And luckily enough for me, at the same time, Carl Frampton moved over. Now we've got Catroll there, Rocky Fielding's there. Like all them names you named, they're amazing, amazing fighters. And that was a bit of luck for me, because now it's perfect in terms of sparring as well, because Carl's around my weight. He's just one weight above me. So in terms of quality and sparring and learning off someone, who better to do it off.
There you go, and get around.
And what was the process of that turning pro? Because he was down in London first, so you'd signed with Haymaker Promotions and he was training down there with Ismail Salas, who trains Linares.
He's not with him no more, though.
He's not with him now. How did you end up in Yorkshire Boy in London down there? What was the
process? It was a weird one. Like, I spoke to him, they told me all the right things, and I thought, you know what, let's give it a go. At the time, it was hard for me being in London. It was hard, obviously, being away from home. But like right now, it's perfect. Manchester's an hour away from my house, so it's not too bad. But like I say, we had problems. We shook hands. We kind of called it a day before anything even got started. I think that was the best way. And then my next step was match room. I spoke to Eddie Earn, and we sorted something out there. Whatever he says, I pretty much do. Otherwise, it kills me. Otherwise, he puts it on me in the gym. But that's the way I like it. What I've always needed personally, in my opinion, is someone to like kick me in the ass sometimes. Because sometimes I can get a bit lazy. And in terms of Kel, that's exactly what he does. He doesn't beat around the bush. He's very straight up. And that's exactly what I need, the pro game.
Are you mainly based at the VIP gym? I mean, today we're here over at the Exigo gym in Rochdale.
Yeah.
Doing a bit of strength and conditioning, that type of work, I'm sure. And you know, what's your sort of routine, weekly routine at what you and Kel do?
Yeah, we pop in here at the 1PT gym in Rochdale when we can. We're mainly at the VIP gym. We're also at Moss Side, ABC, obviously, Nigel's gym, Nigel and Kel's gym. So they're the three main places we tend to go. But apart from that, like, if we need sparring or someone wants some sparring, we'll go wherever. We're ready to travel. Like I said, I travel from Leeds every day, so a couple more miles, say, to, I don't know, Manchester or Rochdale, like here, or Oldham, whatever. It's not too bad. But they're the main three gyms that we're at.
Second pro fight this Saturday, we just touched on it then, Amir Campbell. Ricky Starkey, you're going in against. Tough, rough lad, you know, he'll come to fight. He's certainly not going to walk around or look to, you know, give you an easy night. So it's a good opponent for your second fight. What do you know about Brett, and you know, what are we expecting from you?
Ricky Sack, yeah, he's tough. He's a former army lad, isn't he? I was saying to someone the other day, they told me that he's been blown up in a tank or something like that. So I've heard. So I was saying that he's not going to be coming in the ring being scared of me. You know what I mean? But that's what I want. I prefer that. Like, I boxed that Brett Fidel before my debut, and once I hit him, he kind of just ran away. He just was there to survive. But now, with Ricky Starkey, someone's going to come at me. That's what I prefer. And he's probably thinking, yeah, I'm going to come in there, and you know, I'm going to put it on him. He's not going to like it. But trust me, that's what I'm here for. If you're not coming at me, when you're coming at me, it makes it easy for me. I ain't got to find you. As soon as he comes in, I'm looking to, you know, make him pay. And that's the plan for the weekend. But yeah, he's tough. He's tough. He'll keep coming. And his game will probably try to rough me up, but I'm used to all that. Like I say, from all the experience in the amateurs, I've been through all of it, especially against them little Eastern Europeans, like Ukrainians, and to come try to walk you down. I'm used to all that, and I'm just looking forward to Saturday and putting on the show.
Do you have a vision in your mind of where you see yourself? I mean, did you do that as an amateur and you ended up going to the Olympics, but as a pro, what are your ultimate ambitions in the game?
I just want to be the best, simple as that. Like I said, I want to get to the top. Same as I did in the amateur game. I want to be the best in everything I can be, and I'm working hard every day to do that. And God willing, I'll be world champion, and hopefully multi-weight and multi-world champion, hopefully.
Anyone who's not seen you yet box, how would you explain what sort of style you are and what they can expect from you?
Mainly, I'm a southpaw first of all, but a switcher at the same time. Mainly counter-puncher, but I like to counter-punch on the front foot and control the fight and control the pace. But I can adjust, I can come forward when I need to. So I'm a mix of everything really, but mainly a counter-puncher, but I like to make them pay when they make mistakes.
What sort of fighters do you look up to? Who's influenced you, and what fighters now on the scene do you like?
Well, first of all, like I said, I'll give you that little story from about Amir Khan, and obviously how it made me think, you know, I can do the same in the Olympics. Apart from Amir, my favourite fighter, obviously, Muhammad Ali. That's just like, one of them people, not just for what you did inside of the ring, but outside as well. My main fighters of all time, I've always been a big fan of Sugar Ray Leonard and Pernell Whitaker. They've always been my two favourites at the moment, and a bit of Roy Jones as well. Current, obviously Mayweather. You can't really knock him. He's done everything he said, and he's got that. I won't say the perfect style, but he knows how to win. Mainly Pernell Whitaker and Sugar Ray. They've always been my favourite fighter, and I've always watched them since I was a kid.
If you could mix a bit of Pernell Whitaker, Ray Leonard, and Roy Jones together, I think you don't go far wrong.
That's me. That's the next time you ask me that question about the style, I'm going to go, you know what? Just think of a bit of Pernell Whitaker, Sugar Ray, and Roy Jones. That's my style.
Yeah. Can't see anyone touching you.
Oh, mate. That's the plan. No one to get it.
Other than boxing, what do you like to do when you're in your spare time, or hobbies? Do you get time to do anything like that? You know, what do you do when you're not boxing?
See, I get this question a lot, but it's tough. Boxing takes over most of your life, obviously. If you're not in the gym, you're resting, or if you're not training, you don't want to do something like, I don't know, play football just in case you get injuries. But to be honest, one of my main hobbies at the minute is five-a-side football. Inside, I love playing a bit of football. Apart from that, just socialising, just obviously when I do get the time to rest, I'm not in the gym, just not getting to know, but catching up with old friends or catching up with family that you don't get sometimes in the boxing game, you're deprived of at times. And like you say, like I missed my nephew's first birthday last week because I'm fighting this week. So little things like that, it's good to catch up with the family and sort of socialise with the old friends.
What do your friends and family think about your boxing? And I'm sure they're very proud of what you've achieved, you know, going into the pros now and you know, going on to that stage. What do you think about it?
No, they're amazingly proud. Mum still can't watch me fight. She's never watched me. She watched me after the fight, like on the DVDs or on the replays, but while it's live, she can't watch. She just can't knack it. But the rest of the family, they've all amazingly supportive and proud of me. But yeah, my friends, everyone's always been really supportive. It's not no one's ever been like, oh no, don't do it, apart from Mum at the start when she fought when I was a kid. But yeah, they've always been amazingly supportive, and it's always appreciated to have like that support behind you and to know that obviously they're with you wherever I go. Or like my dad's and my brothers, no matter where I box, say it could be something mad like Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, wherever, they've always flown out to watch me. And it's probably cost them a lot of money as well, but that's the support they've shown, and they've always come out, even when the beginning, when they didn't understand what was going on, in terms of points scoring and all that sort of stuff, they still came over, and they've always shown me that, and an amazing amount of support.
And like I said, going around all them countries, I mean, what other than your boxing, what a great life experience you've had.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, and, you know, all them places you've been, I mean, it must have been fantastic to travel around the world, and you know, as part of something you're doing like that.
Yeah, definitely. It's mad, like the amount of countries we've seen and the places we've been. Sometimes you may not get much time to, like, you know, go see the sights, but just being there is amazing. Like places like, I don't know, Qatar or like Azerbaijan, somewhere no one thinks to go, but it's a really beautiful place, and they've got a lot of money going to, especially Kazakhstan. People don't think much about Kazakhstan, but last time I went there, I went there about 10 years ago, right? And I went, it was just snow. I went again, I think, about 4 years ago. And in that little bit, in that 6 years, the amount they've come on is unbelievable. So it's amazing, like, obviously, being able to travel myself, going there so many years ago, they're going a few years after and seeing the difference in, like, the change in them as well. And Kazakhstan, I think, is one of them up-and-coming countries. Maybe another 10, 15 years, and it'll be a tourist destination at all.
It's massive as well.
It's huge.
Yeah. Don't they produce a lot of good boxers as well?
Class boxers, some very good fighters. Matchroom just signed one of them, Yelusinov. He's, for me, one of the best boxers I've seen out of Kazakhstan. And even the one at my weight, I told you, he just won the World Championship. So Kazakhstan, in terms of boxing, very tough fighters. And the main one, Triple G, Golovkin, you can't knock him. He's world class.
Kes, it's been great to meet up with you again and having a chat. I've wanted to do it for a while as well, so
thanks for having me.
To do it, it's good finding out about you. You know, wish you all the best in your career.
Appreciate
I've got a feeling you're going to do very well.
Hopefully, that's the plan.
Your name is probably going to be in the tips of people's tongues in a few years, no doubt about that.
Hopefully.
So God bless you, good luck on Saturday.
Cheers.
And we'll definitely catch up again soon.
Thank you very much. Cheers.